All right, what's happening? What's happening, guys? Happy Thursday to you. It is Thursday, November 2nd, 2023. And this morning, holy smokes, man, we got a banger for you. I got Mr. Jay Duran and Mr. VC2 Art, Vinny Candelore, up in the studio this morning. And we're going to talk about a topic that I'm excited to talk to these two about because we live this every day. We study this quite a bit because, you know, we're always, as a company, growing, and we're trying to figure out how do we position talent. And we're trying every day to master the art of positioning talent. And so the title of today's show, shout out to Jenna Silverman, Aces in Places, Mastering the Art of Positioning Talent. Let's get started. I'll do what it
takes. A leader is a person that always sets the pace, that creates the vision. Whatever it takes, 'cause I love the adrenaline in my veins. I do whatever it takes. Success definitely does not have a destination. I think leaders see way down the road. They see years down the road, decades down the road in some cases. One of the things that I focus on constantly is getting enough people around me to be able to push that rock up the mountain, because success is a push up the mountain. It's continuous and ongoing forever. I'll do what it
takes. All right, guys, welcome back to the show. We got a good one for you this morning, man. I was like, last night we started talking about, you know, Jay coming back on, and we're like, maybe it should be Jay and Vinny. And I'm like, dude, I don't know if the audience can handle this. It's a Steelers Thursday. Mm-hmm. We got a big event tonight for the Pavement Group at the game. We got a little tailgate going on inside the stadium for the Pavement Group leadership team. We got the whole TPG leadership team in from all over the country. And yeah. What a better topic to talk about while we're in leadership meeting mode than mastering the art of positioning talent. You know, when we talk about people, you know, one of the things that I've learned in my career is you can have exceptionally talented people miscast in a position, right? Like not in the position that really focuses on their gift most frequently. Mm-hmm. And they will be viewed as a bad employee or a bad fit. And like, it's one of the things as a leader that I try to focus on the most, like how do we get people into their gift most frequently? Doesn't mean, you know, that every person is doing things all the time that is in their gift, but it means, you know, we're looking for that, right? You know, one of the things that I try to do as people enter the Pavement Group is I try to find very gifted people to recruit here that clearly have extremely high ceilings when it comes to talent in a specific area. And you're one of those examples. Vinny is one of those examples, right? Where I met somebody and I was like, I'm not exactly 100% sure how to use this person, which, by the way, for the operations people out there, this drives them crazy that I do this. But it's a way to get really talented people in the door and then figure it out. And by the way, important to note, that figuring it out is a two-way street. Mm-hmm. That's not, you know, just the company figuring out how to use the person because, you know, there's another really talented person in this room that's off camera right now, you know, Trey Tipton over here. And, you know, frankly, there's a lot of things we've figured out that Trey is really good at, but like his actual, you know, contribution to this company, the highest level of it, I believe, has still not been found yet. And so Trey has been patient enough to be able to work through that. Still contributing, still creating relationships with sports teams, doing the nonprofit work, you know, doing all the things, contributing to the marketing team, being the MC for our upcoming top contractor school retreat, doing all the things, right, that put us in a great position as a company. But it is a two-way street to be able to figure that out. And so because I never know how long the answer is going to be, I'm going to go to Jay first, just in case it takes the whole 30 minutes this morning. You know, being a cultural advisor for companies, ours being one of those, what do you see, you know, when it comes to really talented people, recruiting those really talented people, and then how the leadership, how the organizations interact with those people and vice versa? How do you see that like playing a role in taking people like Vinny or like Trey and making them ultimately successful and sticky to an organization.
Talent hits a target no one else can hit. Genius hits a target no one else can see. The founding position has to be creative. It's like you're hiring someone before the company's ready. That's inherently going to lead to a conflict because it means, well, we're ultimately not ready. The fruits of our past labor have yet to even ferment for stability. I wrote this down earlier when you were sharing the topic for today. Influence occurs naturally in proximity. How we influence increases productivity or decreases productivity. So I think that's where the conversation moved towards, the law of the picture. If I want to be surrounded by lions, it's a challenge, it's a burden to be the biggest lion possible. And that'll go back to how I live, how I represent the values in my actions with what I choose not to do, which leads to what I can do. So then that brings me in. This is my final quote for the day. No, not for the day, but yeah, Napoleon. It's, I'd rather have an army of sheep led by a lion than an army of lions led by a sheep. So that's my initial retort, would be that, you know, if we go look at that quote, talent hits the target. If we're going to work for and with an organization, we're simultaneously giving up something that we could control 100%. So to re-give that up every day, we work for someone, serve someone, we have to be re-bought in every day to what we're doing and why we're doing it, how we're doing it. And that creates a challenge to all leadership infinitely in the organization. We have to get re-bought in every day if we're going to follow somebody. That's going to get harder and harder, I think, as we evolve. A business evolves technologically. So that's my retort. Or yeah.
I love the quote about, you know, the sheep led by a lion versus lions led by a sheep. Because I think it's, you know, it's the case in a lot of organizations. So think about this one. You know, you put because leadership is easy to see when a title's attached to it, hard to see sometimes for people if they're not super aware, if there's no title. And sometimes the best leaders, they don't possess a title at all, right? They have, John Maxwell says, leadership is influence, nothing more, nothing less, right? And so the person with the influence is the leader. And so in a lot of companies, you see that leadership position kind of flip a little bit. And, you know, somebody within the organization starts to, you know, kind of take over that, either a small little portion of the organization or in some cases a large portion. And I've seen that happen. And sometimes, you know, the leader is so kind of disconnected from the organization, they don't even see it happening, right? And so then, you know, you get people in positions and it's not working, and people can't figure out why. And it's because the actual leader, the influential leader, has kind of rearranged the deck chairs unbeknownst to the leader. So Vinny, you kind of lived through this a little bit this year. What is your thoughts on, you know, being a person with talent coming into an organization? You have openly said many times that you had no real idea what you were going to do when you got here, mm-hmm. and then figuring that out as you go. And how does that, you know, because I feel like now you're in a place where a lot of your gifts are being used, not all of them, but a lot of them are being used, and you keep finding ways to contribute at a higher level. So what was that like on that journey of being able to do that? Because there's a lot of people watching this show or listening to this show that maybe they have a version of you in their organization, and either that person, you know, in your seat doesn't know how to deal with that kind of journey of not knowing, you know, kind of being in an undefined role. And that's, you know, that's really difficult for people. It's difficult for organizations. It's difficult for the leader too, when people are always asking what their role is when you don't know it yet yourself, but you just know that there's an intuition there as a leader that, you know, someone's going to contribute at such a high level. What was that like over the last going on a year here for you to kind of live through?
Dude, I mean, it's been a lot to process through. You know, I think for me, when I stopped trying to be what, like, I thought you wanted me to be here, and I just kind of just started being myself, was when I figured out what I'm supposed to do here. Like, because coming in, you know, I didn't know. I know I'm supposed to help with social media, maybe paint a few walls. I don't know. We're going to figure it out, right? And then we do the art show together. And, like, that was, like, one of the first big things for me where I was like, you know, I've been promised a lot as an artist, as a creative. And then you get into rooms where the people that make the promises, maybe they start to walk those back a little bit. Or, like, once you deliver or you bring them the influence that they really desired from you, they start to walk back, like, how much they need from you, and you feel that. And, like, for me, the exhibit, like, I mean, just being truthful, I just had met you, you know, a few months before that. And so that was the first thing. I'm like, all right, if this guy really comes through on this, like he's really about it.
Good thing I did, huh?
Yeah. No, we pulled off that exhibit. And, like, from there, it was like a slow, you were trusting me more, I was trusting you more. But if we weren't committed to that process, there would have been a million fallouts before that. Nothing's perfect. No relationship in work is perfect, you know?
Oh, dude, it's a struggle, man. It's always, you know, that, you know, I say this probably almost every day here, but anything worth it is going to be difficult.
No doubt.
And, you know, anything that's difficult will produce something that's worth it. And, you know, just to walk it back a little bit, because, you know, Vinny, we met. I saw Vinny's shoes. Shout out to Benny Fisher, because Benny Fisher had Vinny paint a painting for Gary V, who Benny just dropped an episode with Gary V on his podcast this morning. So go check that out. It's called the Big Fish Cares podcast. Great conversation, I'm sure, with Benny and Gary V in Gary V's office in New York. But Benny had Vinny paint a painting that he was going to gift to Gary. And I saw it on his stories, and I was like, who's this dude? So I clicked on Vinny's profile. And for those who don't get to see me every day, I'm kind of a sneaker dude. Like, I got a lot of pairs of shoes. And so I was like, bro, this guy paints custom sneakers. And so my wheels started going. And I told Trey Tip, I said, bro, we got to get this dude. We're going to, like, give a pair of shoes away every month to kids, or, you know, kids that can't afford them or something like that. So just – and I was like, Trey – he looks like he's a fan athlete, so you hit him up. He ain't going to respond to me. So, you know, you hit him up in the DMs, and let's see if he responds. And next thing you know, we're sitting at lunch together, and we're, you know, just kind of sharing our own visions for, you know, where we're at, where we've been. And, you know, that the idea of casting people in the right places, it really has to start with shared values, the ability to relate to each other. And, you know, Vinny said something to me that day that really got me. You know, everybody that watches this show knows that I'm a spiritual person. And Vinny was like, dude, like, I don't want to be weird, man, but, like, you know, I've literally been praying to meet someone like you guys for months. And, like, I don't know how this would work, but, like, I would love to be part of what you're doing. And I was sitting there at the same exact moment thinking, like, I got to figure out a way to make this guy, like, to, you know, find a way for us to work together. And by the way, that can look, you know, from a tactical standpoint for you guys listening and watching, that can look very different. It can look like a contract position. It can look like somebody, you know, doing their own thing and contributing here. And, you know, kind of what we said was, we never want to take anything from somebody. So, like, you know, Vinny's very passionate about his art. Like, imagine if I hired him here and said, like, yeah, you're going to work here, but you can't do anything else, right? Like, we're going to lock you down and you can't. It's like taking the creativity out of a creative is probably one of the worst things that you can do. And so, you know, you can hire somebody as a contractor, you can hire someone as an employee, and you can still leave that door open. And we had open conversations about, like, dude, I want you to be able to do your own thing. You know, we just are, we're going to grow into having a lot of priorities here.
Yeah.
And, you know, as that evolves, then we need to evolve too. And it's been an awesome journey to be able to watch you find those places where you can contribute, find those places where you don't really enjoy contributing, and communicating that. And I think that's important for people to realize, is, like, when I say it's a two-way street, it's a two-way street from a commitment standpoint. It's also a two-way street from, you know, the leader and the employee or the team member having very open communication. Like, you know, you got to check in a lot, man, because, you know, and both people have to be open about, like, hey, this is where I see this going, or here's what else we could do. Here's what's not working. Here's what is working. and kind of work through that. So what has that been like for you, you know, from a, you know, finding your way, finding the things that you don't like, feeling overwhelmed at times, learning a ton of new stuff, right? Mm-hmm. How has that been as you found your way into this? Because to me, it's funny. I'm sitting here thinking, like, what is your position here? And I'm like, it's clearly defined in my head. Like, but it may not be clearly defined to everybody. Mm-hmm. Like, I think it is for you at this point too. Like, you kind of know where your seat is here. But what was that like, you know, finding your way to it?
It was a struggle, man. Like, there was definitely a time, like, there were moments where I had meetings and I'm like, I feel like I'm hitting certain targets, and then it's the wrong target. I'm like hitting the target, but it's like not the one you guys are asking me to shoot at. And so I think just understanding the vision and the mission more of what we're really truly trying to do here allowed me to take ownership of it. And we had like a really, really real conversation one day where you were just, I mean, brutally honest. It feels like your personal brand stuff is here, and it feels like the care that you're giving for like other things may not be there. And I had to really step back and look at myself and be like, okay, what is the reality of the situation? What has gotten me here? You know, what has Brian invested into me? Because like, it's so easy to get clouded in like the day to day and you lose like the big picture of things. But like, honestly, when I adopted TPG and One Team and, you know, TCS and all the things that we're building, when I adopted that as like, this is mine, like, that's when it went different. It wasn't like anymore. I'm, you know, not saying that I ever was using it for personal gain, but when I came in, it's like, I don't know what I'm doing here. So,
well, you would only know what you have done. Like, I'm sitting here thinking now about that conversation. It's like, yeah, it would make sense that someone would, because that's what you have always done. Mm-hmm. Right. And so that takes a conversation. It takes somebody from the outside, like, you know, bringing that to your attention. And it's a good lesson. It's like, man, you got to care enough to be honest, you know, because if I wouldn't have said that,
right,
what is the opposite of that? I would have just built up resentment, right, that I never communicated to you.
Yeah. And honestly, I had never had somebody that had such a, I mean, this is your baby and you're saying like, here, hold it.
Yeah.
And
you tell people what the baby looks like, talks like, walks like, et cetera. And that's a big responsibility.
It was. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So when I embraced that, that's when things, I think, shifted for me. And that's where we're at now. So
Jay, what do you
think? This guy's been writing over here for about 20 minutes. So I'm nervous.
Me too. The thing about the person with the influence is the leader. The person in authority doesn't necessarily have the influence. It wanes.
Mm-hmm.
So if Brian hadn't told the truth, they'll wane over time. We have to re-earn that influence every day. That's why I write and read and attempt to and do this. This is uncomfortable until it becomes comfortable enough to hide. I'm looking in the right place now. It's like how we get influence matters. So actions over words, the order matters. I think people that have talent and are aware of it, even if it's just a voice in their head, the respect is going to come from seeing. And that's Maxwell's law of the picture. Seeing someone that they consider better than them, even if they're not going to say that out loud. And it would be arrogant, even I think, to accept that, like in a position that is someone that's been in a position that those others are going to follow them, right? To accept it. But it's an unspoken reality. And I think if it comes from the person in a position of ultimate power, you know, let's say hierarchical, an authority over subordinate, if it comes from their sacrifice, it's clear that I'm sacrificing. I'm not doing things I want to do because I have a belief in where we're going. And it's clear my actions are in alignment with what I say, where we're going. I think I'm an increased likelihood of people that could very well do their own thing, want to be doing their own thing through my thing. And that breaks down with success. I think about, like, we have a vision, everyone in this room, we talk about it. Okay, this is the plan. This is how we expect it to go. Now, in between all the planning and the expectations and the endeavoring towards it, we have to say no to certain things so we can say yes to other things. Things are still going to go awry, which means then we have to come together and speak, even like we're doing now with the crowd. with this thing, if we're successful, this is the interesting thing. Well, if we were proactive before, that proactive led to results. That is going to force us to be reactive. So despite our success, we're going to react to it. It's going to further increase the likelihood of breaking down in communication, being unsure if we still care about each other or not, being unsure if we're on the same page or not. So that was one thing I wanted to say, was that leadership, you know, leadership is influence. If that's the case, authority doesn't have a causal relationship with influence, though. It doesn't necessitate influence. And in fact, people get promoted. They're being promoted into a new endeavor, an unknown. We're drawing from our esteem, our competence from former labor, former responsibilities. So we're in the dark in this new realm. If we get in a position of authority, there's so many other things we have to unlearn and then relearn while being responsible for other people and ultimately accountable to those beyond us in the hierarchy and ultimately the marketplace. So the actions versus words, I think, is really important. That's a bit. What do you think, Vinny?
Well, what you just said that stuck out to me the most was the whole comment about unlearning and learning. And I'm actually curious what your thoughts are on what's kind of harder to do in a new role. Is it harder to learn, or is it harder to unlearn the bad stuff?
Schopenhauer said, man sees the world through his own field of vision, something like that, to that effect. The limits of our vision, our own field of vision. So in a sense, we become clouded by our competencies, and that's where we have to ask others, hey, what can I do better? Is that?
Yeah.
I don't know if I answered that question, actually.
Yeah. Sometimes I just like need to look at your notes, like after you talk, to just make sure I might watch this episode back to like fully process what you just said. But I think there's a lot of truth in what you said, like, you know, the darkness of stepping into the unknown, it churns up like all these emotions of prior experiences and like fear that you don't want to relive that, because I mean, nobody wants to fail. Nobody wants to let somebody down who puts them in position to succeed. And it's like, you know, you remember the wins, but for some reason for me, like sometimes the losses just scream up here. And so like anytime there's new unknown, like it's a battle to overcome that, because it's like, dude, I don't want to let you down. I don't want you to have to go to Jay and be like, hey, what do I do with Vinny? Like, you know, that's something I don't want to happen. And it's like, well, I learn from my past and I try to do better. And I don't know if that answers what you asked me, but
yeah. Brian. Shout out to Paul Carmichael. He was wondering if we read the comments here. We definitely do. We got him here on the set. So if you have any questions, feel free to put them in the comments always, because you know, we do this show for you guys, right? We obviously do it for ourselves too, because we learn quite a bit talking through these things. But one thing that I do want to unpack there, you know, is I feel like one of the things that I've learned a lot in it, you know, as I've matured as a leader, I think literally age does this for people, you know, in certain ways, it is at least done it for me, is that, you know, when you talk about the title of the show, Aces in Places, Mastering the Art of Positioning Talent, I've become a real believer also in talent positions itself. You know, if you give it enough time, if you can open the space, if you can have great communication and a good culture that encourages people, because you said something earlier, man, that makes me extremely happy. All I ever wanted you to be was yourself, you know, because I saw something in you, right?
Yeah.
I didn't see a tool that I could use. I saw a person with gifts, and that is every person here, by the way. You know, I don't bring anybody in here because they're good at math, or they can paint, or they can, because it's the whole person that you hire. And you know, we talked about this yesterday in our leadership meeting. You don't position an employee into a position. You put a person into a position where they can succeed. And that person, we hire the whole person, meaning we hire their family, we hire their children, we hire their problems. We hire their successes. We hire their experiences. We hire their upbringing. We hire their, right, everything about the person. And I believe that if you give people space and you're not like, there's so many companies out there and so many leaders that are micromanaging people without even their own awareness. They see it as management or leadership, but really what they're doing is micromanaging a person. And what they do by doing that is they put the clamps on a person. They make them actually think, what does this person want from me? Because they're managing me at such a level of detail that clearly they want me to be them, or they want me to be like this other person. Like, I want Vinny to be Eli, right? Like, yeah, that doesn't work. It doesn't work because you hire an individual and your responsibility as a leader and how you find and position talent comes down to this. It comes down to figuring out what somebody's real gifts are, reinforcing those gifts, finding places that they can use those so that it lights them up. Because, you know, what I've seen in you and many other people in this organization is as we've created the space for them to be great at what they do, like, dude, I know that you look at the thumbnails that you create on YouTube and you're like, bro, that looks pretty, fire, right? I know that there are things that we produce from a video standpoint that get shared out that the team is really proud of. You know, they hit social media and they get produced. Recording the podcast with Ed Milet and having you guys in here and that being released, like, that's a good feeling, right? It's utilizing those gifts to your highest potential. And I think too many people do that wrong by not creating the space or micromanaging and, or what I said earlier, taking something away from people. And it's like, no, man, if we're really doing our job, everything that is a gift to you becomes a plus one multiplier to the company. And it enhances your gift. If we can give you additional skills by the resources, the people, the connections that we have that are teaching you something, that regardless of whether the pavement group is someone's lifelong journey or not, they're better for having stopped here. Like, that's the idea. And if we do that, we create the space and the people find their own way, right? They find their own way. They say, like, hey, I don't really like doing this. This kind of sucks. And we've had those conversations too, right? This is not good for this person. They don't thrive in this environment. Okay, great. Well, let's figure out how to not have that happen as frequently as possible. Like, doesn't mean that we never have to do things we don't like, but it means that we can hire people that love that. Like, there are people on our team, dude. If I had to do Trisha's job, Amy's job, Mike's job for that matter, it would not be in my gift, right? But if I can step into my gift as often as possible, be a visionary, bring people together, lead the organization, keep the vision of the organization out in front of people, keep expanding that, keep finding all the different things that the pavement group and our entities will become. That's my gift. And so I've said this to you before, but, like, you know, when we were in the middle of setting up the art show, you know, I was like, this is mind blowing to me. Like, I, you know, people say this to Vinny all the time and, you know, he probably gets sick of hearing it, but, like, I couldn't paint a stick figure well, like, and, but business is my art. Bringing people together is my art, right? Like, being able to cast people in positions and see the gifts. Sometimes it's seeing people needing to be recast in a different position. Sometimes that position is outside of our organization because what we have right now, what we need, it's not going to be a good fit. And that's a mistake on me as a leader to not have seen that soon enough, but that's going to happen sometimes. Hopefully it doesn't happen very often, and here it really hasn't. But, you know, talk about that, man. Like, how do you see that here? Because, you know, you interact with a lot of people, have a lot of space to kind of find their gifts. What does that look like on a day-to-day basis for the people out there that might be leading companies that say, like, well, how the heck do you do that? Like, how do you actually, you know, keep people working if you're not, you know, having your thumb on them all the time?
Yeah. I think, I don't know why this is screaming to me, but, like, humility. We talked about it the other day. Humility is huge. Like, you have to have the ego to get in the room and think that you belong in the room. But the humility of when you get in the room, being able to be like water and, like, form to whatever needs you need to be poured into. And when that needs to change, you know, like you said, it's a ebb and flow. It's a give and a take where, both sides need to be willing to come to the table, be humble, be honest about what is being done, what needs to be done. Because if the truth is like, if you and I have the same vision and we can sit down at a table and see where we're supposed to be going versus where we're going and be honest about where we're lacking, where we're succeeding, then with the same vision, we get the same result and we get the same answer of how to get there. It's just a matter of, are you humble enough that if the result is you not doing a specific thing, or maybe it doesn't match what you had thought you'd be doing, are you humble enough and are you willing enough to still say, I'm part of this team and I'm going to make this work. And I see myself, I see that's why you're, you know, we're at this point. I don't know if that makes sense.
Yeah. But Jay is writing feverishly and I want to get to him, but I do want to say this. Everybody takes their turn shoveling the shit. And so, you know, it's a real indicator when people don't want to do that. And mm-hmm. there are people that are no longer with our company that really didn't want to take their turn doing that. And for you to be part of a high performing team. And by the way, when you're making real progress, man, stuff is breaking frequently,
like all the time,
all the time. It needs rebuilt. And to your point, like, we all have to have the humility to say, how can I help? You know, how can I contribute? How can I be part of that solution? And that is how you actually uncover people's gifts too. It's like, right, man, if somebody's too, I could tell you this, man, if somebody's too good to take the garbage out, they ain't working in this place. Because at the end of the day, dude,
yeah,
I've been in the dumpster outside and you have video to prove it.
In Louis.
Yeah.
Jumping up and down, in a trying to make more space.
In a pair of Louis shoes. Thank goodness we got Jesse up in here. He can fix that and clean those all up for me. But Jay, what do you think? I'm interested to see what's on there.
Thanks for asking. Humility.
There's some large text I see that. Yeah.
Yeah, there's like a humility comes from service. It's proactive. Service. The success of service creates reaction. I'm entitled now. So if I'm not proacting once again on a new paradigm, then I'm going to negate my humility. Humility comes from service. So what that means is work. Work changes. So, you know, I wrote that in conflict, our relationships may change as we climb the hierarchy, but part of work is service. It's engaging. It's developing relationships. That's part of work. It's serving. In proximity, the senses, people have to see us, feel us, touch us, be with us. That means we have to be there. I'm a slave to Culture Matters. I work for Culture Matters. I'm proud of that. I have nothing else going on outside of my fiance, who gratefully so is my keeper, my coach. And I get to be, you know, it's easier when you work together every day, but we are servants. We serve you. We serve those that have given us the opportunity to work. And with that comes tremendous potential for entitlement and arrogance and reactivity. So the power of service has to come from a deeper place than the aesthetic, the fruit, all the people I'm mad about from my childhood that I want to say I did it, told you so. That's a very sad something about there's a complaint in every revenge in every complaint. So humility comes from service. The thing about unlearning is when we are at a new level, we not only have to unlearn other behaviors, we have to learn new behaviors. So some, you know, Brian, as a leader that you are, you surround yourself by smart people and you attempt to learn from them and you bring people together. We're all in this room because of you. That's a testament to the relationship piece of a leader. But that service piece, these three things, humility comes from service. We may forget that or lose sight of it, or as we get success, meaning outcomes, we have to be in conflict. We have to be in proximity. Our people need to feel it and touch it and be with it. And the last thing, communication, speed, and openness. So, because ultimately, there are many people right now that I'm not physically with that I serve, and I have to be with them in spirit. That means communication. That means speed and communication. And it's, you know, I think if we really love what we do and we're all in on it for whatever reason, whatever impulse, we're setting ourselves to let people down because there's only one of us. So there's going to be frictions because I'm going to say, hey, I'm going to email you back. And then it might be the next day I do. Well, I better be ready to apologize for not, even if it's just a subtle accountability of, hey, I didn't do it. So that would be my retort, is that humility comes from service. That means work, and it's time spent and how it's spent. And it's a lot. Entitlement is a symptom of success, and it has to be fought with time. And then this goes back to the business owners listening to this that, you know, may have caught their potential or exceeded where they thought they'd ever be in their life. You know, lean into mentors and role models, maybe invest in yourself and have people help you get clear on, well, what's next? Because if there's nothing next, well, everyone that you've built up, all your mentees will leave you, as they should, just like the child should leave the womb, or the baby should leave the womb and the child should leave the home. But if we're going to be surrounded, you know, so that would be what I would say, is it's a testament to the power that you have, Brian Hess, that we're all in this room here, and you brought us all together, and you've even given us a space to talk freely on this show. It's a power to integration. It's a revealing of integration. It's a revealing of courage. It's a revealing of honor, because it's a vulnerable act even. That's all service. It's humble. You're entitled to not have to do the show with anyone in your culture or part of your culture. It could just be you talking to yourself or through yourself, to yourself, to whoever's listening. And so that excites me about being around you, and Vinny too. But that's what was on my mind. I was like, you know, because that influence comes from, you can have influence through the mere fact that people perceive you as better than them. Genuinely too. So like I have a lot of idols, like people I admire. Like, wow, look what they've created. If I meet them in person and how they relate to me is not, you know, open and honest and caring, and then I'm going to, and they'll become my enemy, and I'm going to be like some Darth Vader shit. So yeah, humility comes from service. I think our culture generally as a whole, we're succumbing to some really scary narratives about this, you know, there's got to be something better than where we are, or something better than the conversation we're having right now, or some job out there better than, or some career out there better than. It's like work works. Work fills us up. What is work? You know, it depends on our role, obviously, but it's people, it's products, it's services. We got to work. I mean, and yeah, it might be different for some people. It could be 50 hours for you, or 70 hours for you, or 80 hours for you. If it's less than 50 and you own a business, I don't know what to say to you. It's probably an OnlyFans. I'm going to do my best to not bring that up again, but two probably going to happen.
Two for two.
Well, because I think a lot of the personal branding stuff is this close to OnlyFans, because I'm selling a part of who I am right now. Yeah. Like the barter right now is my spirit. Because I'm here with you guys, and I got all these other people talking to me and looking at me or interacting with me. So like I've commoditized my spirit in this moment. So yeah. It is kind of close to OnlyFans in that
way. Just more clothing.
Yeah. Yeah, but it is sexualized still.
Still, I own a ring light.
How did we get here?
That's a good question. You always find a way to get us there. So we'll have to figure that out.
I don't think he had.
You know, Nietzsche said, "Be careful when casting out your demon that you don't lose the best in yourself." You know, I don't want to lose the best of myself, so I'll bring it back.
Oh, I will say this, because you know I could attempt to unpack what Jay just said, but we need to wrap this up here. And I'll just say this, you know, as a leader, because you said something in there like maybe you've reached, you know, what you thought you were capable of. And through the work that Jay and I have done together, and I can pay him this compliment, so just in case he cries, we'll be done with the show. But, you know, it's been, you know, well over 4 years of us working together. And what somebody like Jay can do for your life, what a mentor can do for your life, what somebody can see is that the mentor is always going to see more in the mentee than they see in themselves. And that's – our responsibility to be that as leaders within an organization. It's my job to see more in you and to see the gifts in Vinny that he may not always see in himself or may not believe in himself, or he doesn't charge enough for his stuff. And it's my job to push him to do that because I believe in him more. And so what Jay has been able to bring to this company and to me personally and to my family is to be able to see more in me than I've seen in myself at times, to push me beyond the limits of what I was comfortable with. And that's the real gift in all of this. You know, when you talk about mastering the art of positioning talent, make sure you have somebody that loves you and cares about you and is really leading you with your best interest in mind. And this is the best compliment that I could ever pay this guy, is that I know for sure that he has led me in directions that have not been the best scenario for him, but has looked at that as this is a long play. Like, I plan on being here forever. Like, we're family. And so I'm going to do this because it's the right thing. And that's not always the case. And so go find yourself somebody like that in your life. Make sure that, you know, for those people out there that are listening to this and saying like, man, I don't work in a place that's, you know, looking for these things or even having these types of conversations, man, don't spend another day trying to track down, you know, opportunity in a place that doesn't see it for you. You know, be the person that leaves that place and goes in pursuit of something. You know, something that I respect a lot that Vinny said when he came here, he's like, you know, I decided because his dad passed away young and never got the opportunity to pursue his real passion, which was art. He was like, man, I watched my dad, you know, work hard. Ultimately, I'm using my words, not yours, but like suffer through trying to, you know, provide for his family. And he never got to pursue that passion. And so Vinny was like, I'm not going to do that, man. If I'm going to suffer, I'm going to suffer doing it in my gift. And so, you know, from me to you guys, man, it's a pleasure to be able to sit here with two people that I get to watch use their gifts every day. Two geniuses, in my opinion, in their own craft, and with people, most importantly, like, you know, how we interact with people. And so as a leader, you know, if you're out there and you're wondering, like, how do I fix this? I don't have this in my organization. The first thing that you have to do is invest in yourself. As Jay said, you know, you got to fix yourself. That's an inside job. It goes from the inside out. And as you do that, you're going to be able to find, you know, those people that are going to make you better, that are going to believe in you as a leader at a higher level. And that pushes you through those limits that you thought were impossible to achieve. And that's how, you know, to wrap this up in a really nice bow, that's how you position yourself in the right place, right? How you put your own ace in the right place, which is yourself. And when you can live in your gift and you feel that every day, you know, I say this to my wife quite frequently, like, I can't believe what I get to do every day. Like, I can't believe what I get to do and who I get to do it with. It doesn't feel like work, not 100% of the time, but 99.9% of the time, this doesn't feel like work. And so I encourage you guys, get people in your life like this guy that can help you see the things in you that you may not see in yourself, that will push you, that will be selfless in that pursuit of excellence for yourself. And when you do that, man, there is nothing that's going to stop you. And when you can get those people around you placed in the right positions and cast in the right places that they can live in their gifts, it's about as close to heaven on earth as you can get when work is involved. You know, it's never easy, but it is an absolute joy to get to do it every day. And, that's because, you know, you get to do it with people like this. So love you both.
Love you. I want to say, you know, you changed my life. I mean, I go into this profession as a servant, so I'm learning every time we have a conversation. I'm not the same person I was all those years ago, and you're part of that. Those that have given us an opportunity to be servants are part of that. And I think that's a metaphor for the relationship of people in work, is that for those listening, you can learn from the people that have given you permission to give to lead you in a certain capacity. Like, we learn from we're all equal, like, in how we interact with each other. So I you know, the feeling's mutual. It's, and that's very important. I can't imagine even attempting to do this line of work thinking that I wasn't going to learn every single time I had a conversation with somebody that gave me the opportunity to serve. And I think that's important to say, But yeah, you've helped me find my voice in a lot of ways. You've helped me love. So thank you.
You're welcome. You're welcome.
Vinny? Copy, paste.
Awesome. Well, this was a great one for me, man. I hope it was a great one for everybody out there. Appreciate you guys tuning in, and we will be back tomorrow.
We got a special episode in the morning for you guys, so make sure you are subscribed. Specifically subscribe to the YouTube channel. I know people watch this on different platforms, but there are a ton of videos that you're probably not even seeing because they only drop on the YouTube channel. That's the main hub. So even if you watch this live in the mornings on, you know, LinkedIn, wherever it may be, still go subscribe to the YouTube channel because we got a lot of great stuff on there.
Yeah, we've got a very special episode tomorrow for you. It's my pastor, Pastor John Nuzzo, he'll be hanging with us at the Steeler game tonight, and we'll drop that episode in the morning. But there's so many parts of it that that will touch you as a human being. You definitely don't want to miss that one. So 8 a.m. Eastern on the YouTube channel, that one will drop. And we will see you again tomorrow morning, same place, same time, right here on The Brian Hess Show. God bless. We love you guys. Thanks for being here. I'll do what it
takes. A leader is a person that always sets the pace, that creates the vision. Whatever it takes, 'cause I love the adrenaline in my veins. I do whatever it takes. Success definitely does not have a destination. I think leaders see way down the road. They see years down the road, decades down the road in some cases. One of the things that I focus on constantly is getting enough people around me to be able to push that rock up the mountain, because success is a push up the mountain. It is continuous and ongoing forever. I'll do what it takes.